Well, we are a quite a big school with a lot of studies, a lot of students, and we got a lot of computers that we have to update with operating systems. We start thinking about using virtual desktops. Virtual desktops, we explore a little bit what was in the market and was very expensive to deploy this kind of virtual desktop infrastructure in a school. We don't have enough money to support this kind of deployment. So we start thinking, hey, maybe we can just code all this and we can make an application, a web application, where students can access and create their desktops based on templates that the teachers previously have prepared. And we need some kind of fluent software and infrastructure to deliver everything to all these desktops to the students and the teachers. So more or less, this will be what we will be explaining. A little bit of introduction, someone doesn't know how it works. What is now in the market of virtualization? What were our goals that we wanted to reach with this project? The technology we have used to build everything. You will see that there is the software that orchestrates and creates, delivers all the virtual desktops, but there is a lot of infrastructure under this software that we also build from ourselves. We don't have money, but so we have to build all the servers and everything overall. And then we will talk about what is involved in this kind of deployments. What are the main problems we have faced during this project? We started a few years ago. I don't remember, 5 years ago maybe, with this project. And we will see all the problems we have faced. And then how the software works here in the school and how we have implemented. Virtualization is the software that provides us an abstract layer of hardware where we can run any operating system. With desktops, we need this kind of virtualization to have a full desktop with servers. We can use Dockers or kind of implementations, but we need to use an abstract layer that emulates the hardware of a real machine. We have different kind of virtualization systems, and there is an API called UKIP that let us from different softwares access this virtualization systems, and IsardVDI uses this UKIP as an API to organize, to orchestrate all these hypervisors and all these virtual desktops that run in the hypervisors. What is the state of the art? What is the current state? There are more, but the main virtualization systems that we can find today are based on Shen, Vitrix, KVM is what we are using, Weird from Red Hat also uses many KVM. These are mainly the free and open source blockchain has some kind of private drivers for some kind of cards, especially graphics cards. But mainly it's free and open source. And we have VMware, Microsoft Hyper-V, that are private virtualization systems. All of them have pros and cons. We tried Ovirt as a free open source 5 years ago. It was a huge software that need very expensive resources on the machine, and also a quite a complex infrastructure. And in the end, we wanted software that could quickly deploy virtual desktops to students and teachers. So in the end, we forgive everything and started from scratch with our goals. To orchestrate all this and to have a quick deployment, we start thinking about the template system, and there is a file storage system, P2, that allows us to quickly create incremental disks on the fly of our templates. So it's a real quick system, file system to the storage of these virtual desktops. And then also wanted to deploy it from a standalone or all-in-one system to a big infrastructure that is what we have here in the school. We have over there a small box that is like a later we will show you that. It's a small box with a computer and allows to run 20, 30 virtual desktops to students in a classroom. So that would be the standalone system. And another important thing was to have an infrastructure of storage that was independent from our software. So we are not tied to any kind of file storage. You can use whatever you want. Also, we don't want any daemon to be running on hypervisors that we have to install, and we are tied sometimes to libraries or the graphic system of the hypervisors. So, in theory, you can run it in any Linux with an SSH connection. And also, we have implemented hypervisors pools, so we can manage different hypervisors that we can have all around the school from a centralized place. And also the viewers, clients are the students, and the students pay to the school with their own devices, so we need to also allow access from these devices. That's why we have implemented also browser access to these virtual desktops. And also we have a lot of statistics to monitor and process what's happening in our system. We are using these technologies, all open source, KVM and KEMU to run the virtual desktops on the hypervisors, LibVirt as the API to access this virtualization system, also a database that is a document oriented database that allows us also to have a real-time events on the user interface. It's so useful to bring a user real-time experience. Python as the main code that we have implemented on the system. Flask to the user interface and WebSockets to deliver these database events and virtualized events we have. Well, this will be the infrastructure where we run the software. On top we have IsardVDI. We have different different services running at the web app, the user interface, the engine, like a kind of API for us, the database between them, and this controls everything. We have some hypervisors that have direct access. Actually, we have six hypervisors that are that share the storage system. Everything we have built everything from scratch, so we have checked the hardware. We bought everything in parts and we assembled everything because it's cheaper. Also, we have tested many platforms to see what is best for us. And also, we have a network with 10 gigabyte trunks, and we try to deliver 1 gigabyte desktop access from the clients to bring the best experience to the user. Lately, we will see a little bit more of this. I will explain a little bit how we implemented this to be reliable. In the storage, we used the main problem when you start 80 desktops, 100 desktops, is that all these desktops are going to try to write on the disk a lot. So you will have, you will need disks that let you 100 virtual desktops write at the same time. And when you have rotational hard disks, you cannot handle all this IO throughput. So we have used new hard disks, NVM hard disks that are quicker for writes. And to make the system redundant, we have a pacemaker, a cluster with two servers. Both have 8 terabytes of room, and actually we have over 2,500 desktops created on these 8 terabytes and 9 terabytes. This is we can have all these desktops hard disks in only 8 terabytes because we have implemented an incremental disk creation. So later you will see this. And we can have any file system, but you need a cache storage system because this quick hard disks are very expensive, so you cannot afford to buy a big size hard disk, and you need to have a cache on these disks and then write it down to the next to the rotational disks. Here we have, for example, with Fire, I don't know if you know this. FIO lets you test the hard disk and see what's the difference between the specs that that they say it will have with the real specs you get. Here you can see that you get 2 gigabytes of read and almost 1 gigabyte of write. What we used is an exchange system that allows us to have the writes from the hypervisors directly to the NVM hard drive, that it's not so big, it's 400 megabytes, I think. And then, when the system is on low load, the cache writes the data on the rotational disks. So here we monitor this cache, and we have here a lot of writes. This goes directly to the NVM disk, and after a while, the cache starts writing down the data to the rotational disks. This cache is the Encensio IO cache. It's also a cache. We have created also many caches, and this was the one that allows us to set all the parameters. We can set thresholds when we want the flick disk to write down to the rotational disk the data. And we monitor everything, so we can see how many desktops are running, how the RAM is behaving in these hypervisors, and for example, the NAS, the network access server, where are these disks, how is catching all this data.
So about this double layer enhanced IO thingy, what about consistency? I mean, what does it do if you have a power?
Yeah, power failure or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have power batteries for the servers, so we can. They can stay without power for half an hour, then it would shut down. But it's a permanent cache. So when it boots again, you will have the same cache on this disk. It's different from using RAM or.
So it will continue syncing from there.
Yeah, no problem. Also, we have. In this cluster, we have a DRDB connection to keep the data synchronized, and also the cache is synchronized between these two servers. So in case of failure of one server, also the cache is still on the other. Here we can see it. We have split the storage in two groups, and one of these servers is delivering one group of hard disks, of virtual desktop hard disks, and the other is delivering the other group. In case one of the servers gets down, the other one will take both services and serve everything. Here we have the post status, who is, for example, now has one service in one network access server and the other in the other access server. This also allows us for better performance, because not only one machine is delivering the I/O to the network, we have this running in one group, this running in the other group. We have faced a lot of problems during these 5 years. Another one was that, for example, you plug a 10 gigabyte network card in your mainboard and you start doing tests and you get only less than 5 gigabytes per second when you expect 7, 8. And then you realize that there are services on Linux that dynamically maps the outputs of the network of the card to the fit CPU threads, but this is dynamically. So you have to map it statically, each output of the network card to one network core in the CPU. Then you can get, you have the comparison, you can get more or less what you expect from a network card of this speed. Also, Linux non-operating systems are not set to handle these 10 gigabytes per second speeds, so you need to tune a little bit the parameters of the TCP IP stack to get more buffers, bigger buffers, to get these speeds. We use NetPerf to simulate real traffic, and we adjust these parameters to get also better spec. One advantage of doing everything ourselves, from building the servers, including the cards, including the switches, everything, and the software, is that you can touch any parameter that you want in your system. You cannot get that when you buy storage from a big company. You get the box, you plug it, and it works. But you can usually, it's not easy to get inside and see what's happening. For example, with hypervisors, we have some Intel server cards, mainboards. We also bought Supermicro mainboards with dual Xeons, a lot of RAM. And in the end, we also tried, because it's so expensive also, to buy gigabyte gaming last generation mainboards with last generation CPUs that have better speed. And in the end, if you put in balance what it costs Intel server mainboard, what it costs a gigabyte, and also a Xeon or an i7 CPU, and the performance you get when you run the desktops there, sometimes it's better to have two hypervisors with a gigabyte mainboard and not big and Intel server mainboard with two Xeon sockets and a lot of RAM. The performance will be better if you distribute all this load in different hypervisors, and also it's more cost effective. Well, also in the hypervisors, we realized that we had to split the network traffic. So we need different guards to access this storage that we have seen. We use 10 gigabytes of net guards, independent from viewers. And viewers, you then will have opportunity to test the system and you will see some demos. The viewers also need a different interface. We use a Spice viewer. It's a protocol that works quite well with this kind of virtual desktops. And we have tested the network throughput, and it gets from 2 megabytes to more than 100 megabytes. So if you multiply this for all the time you have, in the end, you need also 10 gigabytes or bonding multiple interfaces. And for these virtual desktops that are running on the hypervisor, are going to access to internet, to the network. So you also have to bring a big connection for these desktops to access the network. We also use all the networks to access internet through the virtual desktop. Of course, for the client, the lag, for the viewer, the lag is important. If the network can be configured with a QoS system, it's better to prioritize this kind of traffic over the rest. The throughput, we have talked about that. And we try to bring clean access to 1 GB and the trunks to the servers. We try to get 10 gigabytes per second where we can. Viewers. Currently, we have implemented Spice and browser access also with the client. Spice is better performant, but needs client installation. Browser client requires a proxy socket that makes some coding over this traffic, video traffic, to deliver it to a browser. You need to install this proxy socket somewhere. You can have one machine that brings all these viewers and makes a proxy between all the hypervisors and the clients. Or we have installed this proxy on all the hypervisors just to not have a bottleneck, but we are testing this. Maybe it would be a better option to have all these servers in another server. And LDP that with Windows clients work well, but we are still testing this option. With the Spice, you have the virtual desktop definition, you have a lot of parameters you can tune, you can change, and try to adapt to the kind of application or the kind of use this desktop will be doing. This is also another wall to enter in, and you can get better performance if you touch all these banners. Basically, virtual desktop in a KVM virtualization is an XML file with all the definition of the hardware. You can define the memory, you can define the hard disk, the network, you can define everything, you can touch everything of the virtual desktop. This is one of the main parts of this IsardVDI system. There is one interesting thing on this KMU virtualization, that is that you can overcommit the memory on the hypervisor. This means that you can have virtual desktops running in a hypervisor that in theory will consume more RAM, more memory, than the hypervisor has physically. This is also dangerous. You must take care with these parameters. But you can have a memory unit and a current memory unit. They call it a balloon, memory balloon. And this needs in the guest system, in the virtual desktop, you need to install this driver. And what could this service? What it will do is this service will consume the memory that you say. The memory is the memory you define minus the current memory. So this service in the virtual desktop will consume almost half gigabyte of memory, and it will monitor what is doing the operating system. And if the operating system needs more than 2 GB of memory, the balloon, the service, will shrink the size, will get smaller to bring more memory to the virtual desktop. This means that all this memory that the balloon is using is delivered to the hypervisor. So the hypervisor can have more free memory if the virtual desktops are not using it. And in case one virtual desktop needs more memory, that balloon will shrink a little bit to bring more memory to that desktop. Well, this is data from our database, ThingDB database. We have a lot of data, a lot of this chaos, network, CPU load of these desktops, and also the hypervisors. We monitor everything. And we are trying now to process all this and apply some kind of improvements to the system. We have a lot of data that we are processing now. Well, the images were animated. We will see it in the demo better. Here we cannot see the animation. What we use is real-time events. We can connect to the database, and this database allows us to monitor if there are any changes on one table or one row, whatever, one document. And when there is change, we can, for example, the user clicks on start or the virtual machine stops, we will get the event there. And we can deliver this event to the interface in real time. Also, you have all this project in GitHub. If anyone is interested in using it or maybe coding with us, we are open, we need some more help. We are two, maybe now another friend will join us in this project. Everyone is welcome. We have all the code in GitHub, and also we have a Docker version that you can run it in a small time without installing anything, that will bring you those five Dockers with all the system ready to use it. Well, we started implementing all this, but now we have done this small box. We call it the IsardVDI cube, and this is all the system, the software, implemented in one micro ITX mainboard with a Xeon CPU and, I don't know, 64 GB of RAM, NVMe hard disk, so everything is inside this small box that we have been testing with 20 to 30 desktops running at the same time. And this is the other line that we are trying to improve now. Well, till here the presentation, and now we want you to see some demonstration of the system with this computer we have here. And also, if there are questions, you will also be able to use the system and see how it works.
Do you want to upgrade one?
Well, we can show it here first. The access page. have some desktops. We have also ports that the users, we can define how many desktops they can create, how many they can have running at the same time, how many templates, you'll see now the template system, they can create. Well, here the ISO images if you want to deploy it. Well, for example, here I have some tests I have done, and I can see here that what is the main virtualization hardware that we have in this virtual desktop. Well, maybe this is not the right data, maybe we haven't started this yet. I will delete, because my quota is full. A moment. I will delete some. Maybe these are tests that are not on the system.
I have touched the same moment.
I have touched the system.
Yes.
We start with another user that has more water. The demo problems. Well, this is the administration page. I will create a new one. The user comes to the interface and goes to create a new desktop. Sets a name. And go to Ubuntu. The software. And you can search on all the templates it has a system. Some templates are the templates that we have prepared, and all the teachers and students created templates from these main templates we have done. We can set also the hardware, how many virtual CPUs it will have this system, the memory. Also we can set things like, for example, which room this virtual desktop will be tied to. We have VLANs over the building, and we have to program some systems that needs to have the same IP in the same VLAN the virtual desktop running, so we can map it to one network. Then we create it, and here we have the Ubuntu I have just created. I start it, and we can access through browser or using the viewer. And we have here it's really quick, the system. Start and run the virtual desktops. Also, the virtual desktop resizes to the window using a spice. You can get this, and it hides like a real system. What you can do then is you can install something here, for example. What we can install, for example, we don't have it's quick. Maybe I have to update. Well, it's easier. We will just create a file to see that it's create a folder, and we just shut down this, this desktop. And here we can convert this desktop to a template for others to use after we have installed all the software. We'll let this name. We can make it private or public. We are working in more granular rights for machines. We can set the hardware also, everything that, that we want. We can set different kind of pools from another place, and we create a template. What? The created the template is created. If I go to templates,
it's a private.
Yeah, I've set it to private, so I'm the only one that can access this template, not the rest of the users. But well, we can create a new one from this Ubuntu. I have here the template. Ubuntu template. I can set the hardware again. I create it. I have it here. So I start it. And I connect to the newly created virtual desktop. And I have, I hope, that is a VDI folder. So, in theory, this is what the teachers do. They just create from a Windows, from a Ubuntu, a Debian, whatever they have in the system. They create a virtual desktop, they install whatever they want, and after that they convert it to a template, and immediately all the rest of the students and the rest of the users can create almost instantly the same desktop. Here we have the desktop, the templates, the quotas. We can also work with the users. Actually, there are almost 1,500 users on the system. We have roles, categories, groups, and different kind of quotas for each of those classifications. Then we have the desktops view, where we can see all the desktops that are on the system. We are almost to reaching 2,500. We can add or configure the graphics that will be delivered to these virtual desktops, the interfaces, the VLANs that we have in the system, different kind of video configurations. We have the templates. Now in the system we have, let's see, 189 templates. We have the base templates that are the ones we create. Split the bases in another place. These are only the teachers' templates they have created, and we have the main templates here. We call it bases, and we have the main operating systems we have to start from scratch. Then we monitor also the hypervisors.
they are online or they are not working. And we can create hypervisor pools or configure how the hypervisor pool works, which hypervisors are going to do disk operations, create disks, stop disks, which ones are only behaving as a hypervisor to start virtual desktops.
You can see the hard one.
No.
No.
This is not implemented yet in this version, it's in development. Then we also have some graph and statistics of the system, how it's working. We can see how many domains are now on the system in real time, and some stats of these virtual desktops. The black ones are Linux, the green ones are Windows. And this, I think, it's the load of these desktops in real time. We also have a tree view where we can see all these disks, this Go2 disks that the people have created, how they are tied to its parent. We have the main systems. And for example, we can go to Windows 7 and see which desktops and which templates have been created by the users. So we can have a view of which is the parent of each virtual desktop. And well, in config we can set configurations, make database schedule jobs at certain times, and also configure where you have your Grafana monitoring system. For example, we have a monitoring system based on Grafana. Where we can monitor, for example, this is the software. So IsardVDI, we monitor our IsardVDI threads, how they are behaving. We have here we have six threads in the engine, in our engine, that monitors all the desktops and all the hypervisors in real time. And we have here if they are working, and also the queues of these threads, that is really useful when you are developing a software to have a view of what is happening with all your threads and all your queues. Here we have the engine and with the database, this is mainly the database, and documents that are read, written in real time. By the system, so we can monitor the database also, how it's behaving. And also, we have...
If you want, you can start...
This is, for example, the last 3 hours, the number of virtual desktops that have been running in our hypervisors. We have also the load of all the hypervisors. Also the percentage of free RAM that is still on each hypervisor. You can see when virtual desktops are started, there is a big load and also a memory consumption.
We are creating now 24 Ubuntu desktops.
You can see it
in the monitors.
Your desktops.
If the demo work,
what flag magic are you using to do this?
To do this, we use Selenium. It's a framework to do tests in the web pages, and we have a Selenium server in all the desktops, and we interact with them, and also SSH is created, I think, and that one moment. Okay, now they are started, and in the Grafana we
see now
in real time.
It's the desktop.
We have developing a system that the balance
that the load balancing it's only round robin. So we do a round robin through all the hypervisors, and now we will start developing a better performance orchestrator that can get all the memory, the memory that is free, and also load of each hypervisor, and decide what is better to run the next test. One thing that we have realized also is that for a cache system, it's better that if you are going to start Ubuntu systems and Windows systems, virtual desktops, you start each kind of virtual desktop based on the operating system in different hypervisors, because the performance of an hypervisor starting in the same kind of operating system is much better than if you start mixing all the operating systems in the same hypervisor.
There are a lot of work to develop with these features, because you can load the desktops in live. You can change the desktop that is running in one hypervisor, and in live you can change the hypervisor.
Yeah, you can do live migration. We don't have it implemented in IsardVDI, but we do it through terminal. And we can move one virtual desktop from one hypervisor to another, because the storage system is shared between all the hypervisors, so you can move it, and the user almost sees nothing. We have done it doing a ping from inside the virtual desktop, and in some cases you lost one ping during the transition. Most of the times you even don't lost a ping, so it's almost transparent, the migration, the live migration of one virtual desktop to another. This is also another line we have, that this can let us shoot down some hypervisors if there is no big load, and start hypervisors through the power, the network power we have, started when there is more load, and migrate the desktops between these hypervisors. This is another thing we are trying to do.
For us, it's important that other virtual desktop system, it's important that the quick, the speed that you can
response of the
response
system.
Of the system, because the teacher in the class do okay, all people start, and when all the students
click the start, they do it at the same time. So you need some cues on your system to start progressively all these virtual desktops, or create 30 hard disks, virtual hard disks at the same time. You need a little bit of cues and threading system control to don't shoot down all the system at once.
Yes. If you want to test,
if you want to try it, they are also loaded.
One moment, I close the Firefox now, and if you want, you can start the Firefox in the system, because it's better for you.
No, pero el usuario,
¿no? Oh, yes, but the user is simple. It's FSB.
Yeah,
number of
but if they have the user log already,
yes.
Better use this
yes.
Signal.
But, no, sí. There will be a user, no, se les ha pillado nada.
Then also, no?
Okay.
And you can use this, try to use this. You can delete, create, and ask us questions if you have any questions regarding the system. Also, if you have a laptop, I don't think anyone has come with a laptop and want to try the cube, it has a Wi-Fi. You can access Isard, and it will have the same system there, and you can run the stuff there. It's the same built-in standalone computer.
Is the performance much worse on Wi-Fi?
Using Spice, not so bad. It's quite well. Using the browser plugin, it gets worse when. Especially when there is a little video, there's a lot of lag, video or 3D movements.
But it also depends on the number of clients.
Also, it depends on the number of clients. But with only one client, if you have cubes to move on your screen, it's not the experience is not so well. But with cable, it's quite well experience. Now, the other thing we are trying to implement is the GPU. Graphics cards. This is the thing that Citrix and VMware have from years before. They use NVIDIA GPU cards to have 3D graphics high speed. And now this is a closed development of Citrix and VMware with NVIDIA and AMD. Now wants to get a piece of this cake, so they have put a lot of investment in doing drivers for TVM that allows the use of GPUs and look the desktops to these GPUs. This is the only thing that now is still not working, it's in development in the Linux kernel and with some patch. We have one hypro card and we are also trying to get it working with the system. But it's the only thing that it misses the open source virtualization systems, no less.
So the Citrix and NVIDIA thing is a closed source that only works with Citrix?
They have their own drivers for these cards that work with the Shen server, Shen virtualization server, and VMware with them.
And AMD is going to be free and it's going to work everywhere.
I think as AMD is pushing on this, maybe NVIDIA will also open these drivers to KVM, WEMU, and it will be easier for everyone to use. Nowadays it's not possible. Yeah. Any questions? If anyone wants to get involved, GitHub, there is the sources. And if someone wants to develop, just contact us and we are open to anyone that can help. Thanks everyone. We want to try it. Proveu, si acaso, a buscar el pica-pica, una mica.
Yes. Good question, but the camera...
This is not the camera. Well, it's really expensive. It's almost the same as having a real Windows installed. There is some kind of license for virtualization system, which is Microsoft. But you will, in the end, pay almost the same as if you have it on a real one. They allow you, if you have a real one legal, to run the same legal Windows virtualized. One instance only at the same time. So we have licenses of real Windows in the school, and we are not starting more desktops in theory, but licenses we have, so they allow to do that. But in theory, you have to do. You need a special license for each virtual desktop. And that's the problem with Windows. It's better to use open source.
But for us, the deploy of the operating system and software is better with this system than with the physical, because there are a lot of work to do. In this platform, yeah. We have specific hardware that need specific drivers in Windows, and we must speak with the teacher and we...
Yeah, the problem till now is that we had to be experts in all the software that all the teachers in the school wanted to install. Now we start to say them, okay, just install it in Isard. And deploy it to your students and make it complete, and you are autonomous to do all this job that we did a lot before they start using it.
Are you exporting this? I mean, is someone else using this in other schools or other places?
No, there have been interest in other schools. We have some mails from the past 2 weeks. That we have to answer. The main problem is that we have done all that you have seen, Alberto and me. We have family, they are not so happy with all this. And we have no more time to do another implementation, to do the marketing, to everything. So we try to answer the mails. We hope the people there it's able to install, or maybe if they want a cube, maybe it's easier for us to sell the cube with everything installed. But we don't have much time to do.
We spoke with universities, and
yeah.
We have presented the project in UPC.
Some universities have interest, they have seen the system, because all the students, at least the universities, are really interested in a system that adapts to a student class. And they are trying this kind of systems. There are other systems on the market, but the problems they face is that usually there is a closed system. If you want to change something, it's quite complex. So in the end, they start creating another interface to attack the API of that software that they have bought. So in the end, it happens that.
We think that for universities and for schools, this is a project that can save a lot of money. Because you can use the old PCs, and you only need.
Yeah, we have Raspberry. No, this is more computers. We have it on the library. There we have 7 or 8 Raspberries that connect to the system, and you can access the desktops. They are not so well performant. The Raspberry is quite limited, but you can use it for normal use with. Word processing, browsing, and these kind of things. But in theory, when this kind of small machines get a little bit better hardware, it will be easier to have this kind of machines and use a virtual system than maintaining all these big computers.
Are the latest Raspberry Pis still not enough? Like the Raspberry 3?
For graphics, are not enough.
Because the graphic card of the Raspberry is the same as Raspberry 1, 2, 3. It's the same graphic card. And the limit is in the graphic card.
Yeah, the problem is the graphic card.
So it depends.
Well, the problem with the network is if you want to start to open a video full screen, then it will get over 100 megabytes. The SPICE, it will get 110, 120 megabytes. So there is a limit, and you will start seeing a lag on the video.
But if you want to see a video, you can use the Firefox. In the host.
Yeah. Yeah. The main use of this virtualization system on the school is that you install your software, and you have one template for each software you have. And when you arrive at the class, you say to the students, "Okay, get this template and create a new desktop and you start using it." For all the things like creating a document. If you have Linux as a host, we try that, to get the people to use the host operating system.
We have spoke about with the public administration, and we made the cube. And if you buy a cube, you can save money. Comparado con si tú quieres renovar un aula, ¿no?
One classroom needs more or less 20,000.
20,000.
Between 15 and 20,000 euros. And if you can avoid buying new computers and using the same ones you have, it's cost effective. Yeah. But it's a long process also to get involved in all the teachers and students in this system. And you have a lot of problems also to solve with the system. But in 10 years, I'm pretty sure we will have this kind of systems.
The interesting thing is that in the software, in the free software, there are no solutions now. So with this approach, because it's so multi-layer system, you must. No?
It's not only the software. It's all the hardware that is behind that also must be performant to get a good experience. You can have the software, but if you have a rotational storage, when you start one desktop, it will be okay. When you start 10, the system will be useless. So, and also if you want to access the hypervisors to the network, you must tune all your network. It's a complex thing when you want to grow it. So you need all the levels and all the problems that are in all the levels that we have tried to show a little bit before to get the system really performant with a lot of virtual desktop running. Probeu si voleu.
Sí, seguro que sí.